was told that it's going to be a very interactive, sort of formal, informal forum discussion. So I'm just going to broadly talk around the kind of research that I've done so far. And in this session, I'd just like to focus on my research with and about women's rugby in Fiji. And I'd like to talk a little bit about the female masculinity as something that we might like to explore a little further in the region. So my research about women's rugby in Fiji, goes back to about 2010 or 2011. I was doing research mostly about male, Fijian male rugby players and their identity making and their migrations, professional migrations to mostly metropolitan countries. But in the process of my research, I got to know some female women rugby players, and I got massively inspired by them. I got to know them very well, and that's how I started doing research with and about them. And this research, it hasn't been an individual project at all. I've done most of this work with Dr. Kyozo Mona of the University of Worcester in the UK. And more recently, I've been doing this research with Dr. James Johnson, who's standing there in the corner. last year, we did a consultancy study funded by Oceania Rugby to do multi-methods, mixed methods study about the needs of women rugby players and also the perceptions of women's rugby by stakeholders and community members. So that's the type of research I've been doing, and I've also been personally involved in the community as well. Whenever I talk about these women, I get really excited because these are my heroes here. They're just fantastic, coolest women in Fiji. So I'm usually there and cheering for them, or I try to be of assistance to them whenever I can. Dr. Johnson and I have also assisted the Fiji Women's Rugby Union in organising some of their discussion forums as well. So that's the type of research I've been doing so far. So women's rugby research. As you might know, women's rugby is becoming a very popular sport. Apparently, according to World Rugby, it's one of the fastest growing sports in the world, women's sports in the world. So today, even though our usual perception is that rugby is the hyper-masculine sport, the most masculinist sport that you could think of, but according to World Rugby, as much as 25% of the player population today is women, and it's growing very quickly. So as you can imagine, with that growth in women's women player population, there's been a growth in research literature about women's rugby as well. So what kind of things have been talked about in that literature? Well, a lot of things have been talked about in this literature, but one topic that's been debated quite hotly is the concept of the female apologetic. The female apologetic. It's about apologetic behavior adopted by women rugby players in order to compensate for their pursuit of very, very masculine sport. So they may be pursuing a masculine sport, but they make up for it by perhaps wearing a ponytail or wearing a lot of makeup, or they wear dresses off the pitch. So that's been discussed as a female apologetic. And if you look at some journal articles, they've got some really interesting titles, like "We are like a cute rugby team," or "Barbie dolls on the pitch." So this type of behavior by women rugby players has been discussed quite widely. There is a small number of literature that contests this as well, to say that women rugby players have actually used rugby as a space for gender variance and resistance. But it's a minority. As far as I can see, to date, the literature is dominated by the documentation of female apologetic behavior by rugby players, with women rugby players. And this research has been done in the context of usually in the West. So quite a lot of that research is set in the UK, US, Australia, Canada, France, and very little in the Pacific. And what's really important about doing this type of work in this region is because we can contribute new knowledge. For instance, in Fiji, women's rugby is not a space for the female apologetic. And it is actually a space for women rugby players to express themselves there. It's a space for their gender expression. It's a space for questioning gender norms. It's a space for really almost taunting this very patriarchal norms about gender and sexuality in Fiji. And I must say that the large majority of these women, they are masculine, very masculine, so no body dolls. These are masculine women, powerful, tough, strong women. And these women, a lot of them identify as women. So they're not a trans men. A lot of them identify as women, but masculine women. But as most of us know, very strong gender norms in Fiji. And outside the pitch, a lot of times they have not come out about either their sexuality or they do not really flaunt their gender, their masculinity. But in this, on the pitch, they find this space. They use the masculinity of the sport as an opportunity to really explore masculinity, to express masculinity, and even to flaunt their masculinity to the people who are watching. This is us, we're masculine, we're powerful, we're tough. So in this sense, women's rugby is a very different space. And that is something that I think that's quite different from what's been documented in a lot of other places, particularly in Western contexts. Now, I've often felt that this is quite closely related to this concept of female masculinity by Judith Halberstam, or also known as Jack Halberstam. Female masculinity, it's written quite some time ago, but I think it's a very important piece of work. He discusses female masculinity partly as an attempt to really question the persistent binarism in gender research, because we tend to associate masculinity with men. So when we talk about masculinity, we talk about men and what they do and how they feel about men. When we talk about femininity, we talk about women. And I think that's quite relevant here. But the concept of female masculinity questions this. And it's defined as, defined in this way. Halberstam says, masculine women have historically demonstrated that masculinity does not belong to men, has not been produced only by men, and does not properly express male heterosexuality. What we call masculinity has also been produced by masculine women, gender deviants, and often lesbians. And I think what we see in women rugby players in Fiji is very, very closely related to this female masculinity. And I do believe that it's important to explore this and to understand, to appreciate it, to explore this, because female masculinity in the Pacific, even though it's everywhere around us, it's often not acknowledged, it's often not acknowledged, sometimes even rejected or denied. Very often denied, partly because it is probably one of the most oppressed masculinities, it is one of the most oppressed genders in this region. So masculine women are around us, but it's often not talked about, or completely oppressed, ridiculed, condemned. And as far as popular and academic discourses are concerned, you don't see them in these discourses. So gender research in the Pacific, you see very little about masculine women and female masculinity in the region, and also in popular discourses as well. People don't talk about masculine women. And it's quite interesting because there's so much, quite a lot of interest in trans women and equivalent groups of trans women in the Pacific. For instance, in Samoa, we talk a lot about Fafafines. And they sort of given this almost hyper visibility in the region. And we often see these photos of Fafafines in pageants and Fafafines activists fighting for equality, rights and recognition. But no one talks about Fafatamas and Fatamaloa. This comes from my research with Dr. Asenati Chandran, who's going to speak later. We have recently come back from Samoa, talking to a community of non-heteronormative persons in Samoa. And we have spoken to quite a few Fafatama. So in the way of a boy, yeah, Fafatama, and Fatamaloa would be in the manner of a man. So these are sort of these words are the opposite of Fafafine in the manner of a woman. And we have actually spoken to quite a few Fafatamas and Fatamaloa. But what struck us as Nati and I is that a lot of people deny their existence. These people don't exist. And Nati will probably say some people haven't even heard the term. And people don't believe that these people exist. So female masculinity is probably one of the most invisible and oppressed masculinities in the region. And that is one of the reasons why we should be exploring that more. At the same time though, I do believe that when we do research about oppressed genders, oppressed masculinities and femininities, it is important that our research is not just a piece of academic exercise, and I do believe research must be a political act. At the same time, it is a political act, and a lot of us, we are dominant group researchers, we are university academics, and by that fact we are already dominant group researchers. And when we engage with marginalized communities, we need to make contributions. We have to, of course, always exercise critical reflexivity, but also we have the responsibility to contribute to the communities. And I think that's been said time and again by Pacific Island researchers, particularly Tanahoa researchers. They have said this time and again that research needs to extend beyond our offices and our computers, and it has to extend into our everyday lives. So I have been inspired by the Tanahoa researchers and Pacific Island scholars who have been arguing this for decades. So that sort of informs part of my engagement with the women's rugby community. But at the same time, there's this issue that I have been sort of aware of, but I haven't really had a chance to really confront for a very long time. And something that I've been confronting at the moment, the credit goes to Nico. He confronted me in a conference in Prague a couple of months ago. This type of research that we intend to be a transformative act, is it a transformative act? Or can it actually have very destructive consequences, particularly when we do research with oppressed and invisible masculinities and femininities? Are we perhaps putting them at risk of exposing them? You know, when we think that we want to represent their voices, do they want to be represented? Particularly in a profoundly patriarchal society like this, where the consequences can be very severe and serious. Are we exposing them? Are we representing their voices, or are we exposing them? So that is something that I'm starting to think more seriously about. So yes, I do believe that there is an importance in pursuing this type of research, and we need to fight West centrism in academia. But at the same time, how do we do it? So what is the answer? I don't know. I'm still thinking about, I'm still searching for answers and directions. But I guess I do now have this very keen sense, very keen awareness that research is a political act, whether you see it that way or not. It is already a political act. So what you research and how you do your research has consequences, political consequences. They can be transformative, but they can be also quite oppressive as well. So that's where I'm at actually in terms of my research. So thank you for your attention.
I think this issue of representation is an old one, In anthropology, we've debated it fiercely for 30 years. And I would just add to the debate the issue that if we don't represent, if we do not provide a voice for the voiceless, that is not necessarily any better. And that doesn't take the responsibility away from us simply because we don't speak. When we know there are social problems, that there are people who are oppressed, to not speak about it is also problematic, it seems to me. So either way, we have to take responsibility for what we do in the ways that you talked about. The question is, however, somewhat similar, I think, and that is, going back to Jack Halberstam and the work you do with the women rugby players, when they act tough, why do we need to call it masculine? Why do we even, isn't that perpetuating a binary? That if women act tough, they're acting masculine. If men act tender, they're acting feminine. Doesn't that actually add more fuel to the problematic fire? And so even to talk about feminine masculinity is continuing the boxes. It's just saying more people can participate in that box. But it's the same box.
No, I certainly agree with you, and I think that's where queer theories have made the greatest contributions. You know, so then do we do away with the boxes, you know? And then what do we mean by masculinity then? Then of course the word loses its meaning, because the minute you define it, you are creating a new division, you are creating a new a boundary the minute you define a particular group or identity. So I do agree with you.
So, I'm sorry, I meant to add another. So the one way out of that problem, it seems to me, is how do the women rugby players define themselves? And is to privilege their opinions about that.
Yes.
So do they define themselves as acting masculine?
Yes, as far as I can see. I have asked people who are active in the community, how do they describe themselves? So, what is it? Is it lesbian? Is it transgender? Or it's a new kind of... Because some people use terms like violent femininity. So, is it a form of violent femininity? What I gather is that a lot of these women do consider themselves masculine, and the term that at least some of them referred was transmasculine. So not transgender, trans men, but quite a few of them prefer the term transmasculine. So that is why I sort of stayed with the term masculinity. But I certainly agree with you. I mean, yeah, that creates more and more boxes, more and more. And as we create more boxes, we create more boundaries. And that becomes more and more exclusionary, and I guess those are the limits of identity politics in the first place.
Thank you.
Yes, thank you.
I think Fatima in Samoa, I don't think it's associated with women who play rugby. And I think that the Fatima law is a very recent construct. You know, like, Samoans are still getting used to the idea of this thing gay, because to their, moral discourses, a straight man who has sex with a whawhawhene is not gay. He is just availing himself of a substitute woman. And I think that in rural communities that don't have perhaps so much international exposure, nobody cares how women act after a certain age, if they are acting in a manly way, that's not considered to be anything out of the ordinary. So, you know, I think that the emphasis on femininity is very much fixated on young women of marriageable age. But anyway,
Yes,
well, perhaps you've found different things.
Yes, we have spoken. Natty and I interviewed some Father Thomas and Father Thomas, and they have actually felt marginalised. A lot of them, not all of them, but quite a lot.
Well, they would be if they would come out and say I'm a Father Thomas.
Right, so,
but
so
if they just didn't announce that is their identity, then they would probably not be regarded as anything particularly unusual.
Well, according to the people, well, as far as the people that we spoke to are concerned, they felt that they were often not accepted.
Were they also lesbians?
We actually left it to them whether they wanted to disclose their sexual identity or not.
Okay.
So some of them are definitely, some of them are living with women as well. But our research is an exploratory project, so this is limited qualitative data.
If I may just say briefly, it's interesting because Jenny, I used to think like that.
Pardon?
I used to take that position that, you know, they're just part of us somewhat. In the recent research, it was interesting because the Fafa Fine and Fafa Tama, they told us about their history growing up. And there were certain periods in their lives that they, you know, experienced. And some of them were just kicked out of the villages. And these are like in Savai, for example. And this was new to me, you know, as I was born. And I'm like, you know, I never knew this. So it's interesting, you know, Yoko is sort of alluding to the need for more research into this, especially now with the push towards people for human rights. You know, these are all these little groups popping up, and you know, and government too is behind this, and the Sabon government, of course, is very confused about, you know, what to do with these groups popping up and claiming that they should have rights, you know, in policy documents. So it's an interesting sort of topic for more research.
I would still argue Fafafine is a very ancient form of identification, and the Fatama is much more recent.
No. I don't agree with you there. Because I didn't know about Fafatama a lot. Fafatama and tomboy, remember? You know, lots of people say, oh, tomboy. Fafatama.
New word.
But the recent word is Fafatama a lot, and that's how they define themselves.
Yeah, okay.
Very interesting.
We'll have Ruby and then James.
Interesting, because I think my question is sort of lost in this discourse, and I kind of find it really interesting. I was going to run ask a question around the back of what Professor Gatner was saying about why are we creating these binaries and actually situations, and was interested in what those women call themselves, which is what she was saying, but also paying attention to how whatever they call themselves has been influenced by words that have been introduced. And so that's why I thought this was interesting, because what is a new word in Samoa? What is an old word? Should we pay attention to that, how that has evolved? How do we come to that? Because we can influence. I mean, I remember that people growing up, they'd be described as being either looking more masculine. But now, after several years, I wondered who put the word masculine on them. Would they call it that way? Today, I mean, when I was growing up, if you had women are now training to have muscles. I think we credit Michelle Obama for that. And so, you know, people want to look that way, and then you can afford to wear sleeveless, otherwise you don't qualify to wear stuff like that. It's been popularized. But once upon a time, that little girl growing up in the village looked too much like a man, who was kind of describing these things. And the other side of it, what Catherine was talking about, the militarization, I've observed that when women go on peacekeeping missions, which they didn't used to go, and with 1325 we pushed for a lot of these things to change, now they come back and there's a certain confidence in them, but also a certain level of acceptability from the part of communities in society, saying, oh, now she's sort of bold, and I guess what they want to say is she's sort of more masculine and can move around the village and do this. Now that has been accorded a certain kind of respect and reputation and honor, okay? And then the one who chooses not to go to war is sort of then a bit more feminine. The same thing on the streets. I've seen in countries where somebody will be driving too slowly, a man is driving too slowly, and then there is the road rage that says, why are you driving like a woman? So there are all these things that have been placed, and I just kind of feel that in indigenous communities, some of these things have been internalized, not because they were originally called by those names, but a certain infiltration, I mean, it could be positive and negative, but a certain exposure that brings these things, and not necessarily because those communities want to identify with those technologies. So, you know, you're right that maybe a lot more research needs to go into that, I guess. Yeah.
No, that's a really important point, and I said, you know, I decided to go for the Tawhidi, you know, masculinity in the end, because that's what quite a few of these women wanted. And I decided to respect that, particularly because it was going to get published in a paper.
Yeah. This back to the question about perspective, taking the perspective of disadvantaged groups, I think that's crucial to understand the perspective of the disadvantaged group. For example, in America a while back, as far as racism and bias, the perspective or research was only focused on whites and how whites felt about blacks. It was as if the blacks had no souls. They had no spirit. It's just like, is that these things were imposed upon them. They just kind of accepted that, and they were just kind of dehumanized in that process. And in my research, I looked at how do blacks feel about whites? How do blacks feel about what whites do to them? And it turns out there's wide variability. There's a wide variation among blacks about how they feel about whites and white racism. And I suspect in these groups, right, these women what we play as Papa Thomas, Papa Phoenix, I suspect there's also some variation in there about how they feel about her treatment. It turns out that variation has implications for a lot of issues, health issues, stress issues, motivation issues. These people are just as varied as the minority, just as varied as the white groups, right? And for so long, that variation among minority groups was ignored. And that's why I was talking to you. I said, listen, I'm very interested in this research, and I'm very interested in working with these folks and finding out who they are, what they feel, what's the reason they think, what's the variability, what's the basis of the variability among them, and the consequences of that variability. So I'm very excited. I'm very, very excited about the possibility of working with you and learning about these folks, and learning about the variability within them.
Thank you. I think Dr. Yoga has to run. So she has to run. You can still bring up the question. We'll discuss it, and we'll move on to the next presentation.
Can I just like take a comment? I think at what point do we stop treating them as subjects and start involving them as researchers? So that they're able to explore their own
That's a really important point. Definitely. I mean, I'm searching for an answer to that question too. Because I am very keenly aware that I am looking at them, representing their voices on their behalf.
Academic definitions and stuff have come out from them.
So for instance, in the last research that Dr. Johnson and I have done, we have actually relied so much on the assistance and advice and guidance from the women's rugby community. I mean, they are the ones who set up focus group discussions, and they are the ones who advised us about questionnaire questions. So we really couldn't have done that research without them. So I totally get your point, and I'm still searching for what might be the most sort of equitable way of doing a piece of research. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you, everyone.